Actually, today I was thinking we'll do discuss, because I think most of us know the debates around the UID project, and most of us have watched the kind of proliferation of this everywhere. So just in capsule, I thought I'll start with the issues around this and then go on to what we need to discuss now, because most of us are lacking in an understanding of where all this is headed. In fact, most of us are unaware too about where we are now. So we'll just take a look at it. I think one of the lessons we've had is that postmortem work is not enough in this field. We have to do a certain amount of crystal ball gazing and try and understand where we are headed, so that we can contribute in terms of public discussion to what this is about, because it affects everybody. It affects, when I say everybody, it's actually much wider. We hadn't realized how wide this is. It affects everybody in this country that we know. It also affects people in other countries. And the Africa and Latin America, for instance, are completely overrun by projects like this. We are also aware that the World Bank has a direct interest in this project, and that it's been pushing this project to be adopted in many parts of the world. Their motivation, their incentive, I mean, the reason for their being so enthusiastic about this is not immediately plain, except that in one of the meetings which Mr. Nilakani had in the World Bank, after he had explained what this project was, the president of the World Bank, with a great deal of excitement in his voice, turned around and asked him, "So, is what you're saying is that if there is a woman in Nairobi who is at an ATM, and she's at the ATM in Nairobi, and I'm here in Washington, and I can sit here and know that she is at that ATM and that she's operating that ATM. I may not know what she's using it for, but I will know that she is there at this point. Is that possible?" And the answer, of course, was yes, it is possible. So there is a kind of a great deal of excitement about being able to track and see people in real time, and see where they are and the kind of activities that people are involved in. So the World Bank has had that kind of interest, and we also know that the World Bank has made it part of the conditions for their giving loans to say that if you know a national ID project has to be part of any loan that they give. So you have to have an ID project along with it. We also know now that in many of those countries there has been no local test being done of biometrics. They don't, at least civil society there doesn't seem to be aware that there is any report that has come out on biometrics. We know that in India we've had some reports on biometrics, and many of these, some of these countries already have national IDs. They're being converted into biometrically enabled identity projects, national ID projects. We know that in India we've had a few reports, and those reports have shown that the reports which are there, which were produced by UIDAI, show that it's not, you know, it's not wholly reliable. That there could be problems with it. Fingerprint could have its own set of problems. We know that the iris continues to be expensive, and it's not something that has, you know, that's everywhere, and that too comes with its set of problems. We also know that the RBI therefore was, you know, thinking in terms of facial recognition rather than use these, because presumably you can identify a face better than you can otherwise. But we know that facial recognition technology is very, very new. So it seems like the idea of testing biometrics on large population clusters, see, that seems to be the continuing trend. It's not like these are perfected or, you know, near perfected technologies which are being which are being rolled out, but these are technologies which are all in experimental stages, and we are all guinea pigs for that. What we are also seeing is that this kind of guinea pig treatment of populations is not happening only in relation to biometrics. It's also happening in relation to many other projects. And we need to talk a little bit about what innovation means, why rules are a bother for innovation. So we'll discuss some of that, and if I don't do it, just remind me that we need to do it. But if we were to look at some of the major, major ways in which we've been taught to think about it, so that we can start the crystal ball gazing after that. The first set of words that helped us understand this, and even I've said it many times, and others have said it too. The three words were unique, ubiquitous, and universal. We've seen how this rolls out. So when they said unique, many of us thought, and I know I did, that this was about the uniqueness of biometrics. But it was over time we've realized it's not the uniqueness of biometrics that they are talking about. It is being able to identify every individual uniquely with a number. So biometrics may or may not work, but that number is important. We also know that in that unique identification of a person, the UID number alone is not enough. And that there is a greater amount of data that has been seen to be necessary, which is why we have what we call the next three set of things, which is the jam trinity. So you will find that even in the National Health Stack document, one of the prominent parts of that is this thing called the jam trinity, which is Jandan, Aadhaar, Mobile. And since 2010 at least, we've been told that roti, kapda or makan is now passe. It's these three numbers that are going to be vital, which is why we find that throughout the in rolling out of this project, we've been told give your mobile phone number, give your bank account number, link it. If you look at the latest amendment that has come to the Aadhaar Act, the Supreme Court had said you can't ask for it to be used in banks, you can't ask for it to be under the law that was there. They said you can't ask for it to be used in banks or for mobile phones. So now they've brought a new law to say that it's not under that law which was a money bill, but we are asking for it by a separate law. The Supreme Court has upheld the use of Aadhaar. Now we are going to bring in the bank and the mobile phone. The urgency with which this has been brought tells us the significance of the Jandan Aadhaar mobile trinity. So there are multiple trinities of this kind that we find as we go along. So in understanding where we locate this and how we view this, one of the ways of looking at it is by starting with digitization. And I'm just telling you some of the ways in which we've learned to think about it. I'm sure there are multiple other ways, but you know, we have to learn how to understand what is happening in the world around us. So this is just an attempt to do that. The first thing was digitization. So you start with digitization, which for many people seemed like a good idea because it will streamline things. It won't be in multiple registers. It won't go into in tatters. It will be possible to check immediately. So digitization per se didn't seem like a bad thing, except that nobody thought about it in a context where it was, you know, where the plan was that you start with digitization, but you're not going to end with it. There are many other steps before they finally arrive at where they want to arrive. Just one diversion here, that some of us believe that it's not only that we don't know where all this is headed, but those who are pushing the project here, I don't know if there are some hidden people who know where all this is headed, but I think the way we understand it is even those who are promoting the project here and promoting many of these ways of looking at data, even they don't seem to have a clear idea of all the things that will be done and all the directions in which this will go. There are certain things that have been identified, for instance, fintech companies and financial, you know, going down the financial route is pretty clear. Entering children's lives and trying to track the whole thing from birth to, from before birth to beyond death, that kind of ambition to be able to track people, that much we can see. We can see that they are looking in health, in education, and in the context of poverty. One of the reasons we worry so much when it comes to poverty is we are seeing clear signs that there are, you know, there are three terms that became important for us, again another trinity but not produced by the proponents of the project, but which has emerged from among many of us who work in this field, that these three are going to become very significant. One is redundancy, which means the redundancy of people to systems. The second is dispensability, that there are many classes and kinds of populations who are dispensable to the kind of, you know, to the new order that is emerging. And the third is invisibilizing, that, you know, this is something that I think mass displacement movement produced, how systematically there is a way in which people get invisibilized and so you don't see them at all and therefore their problem doesn't exist. And after some time they become irrelevant to the whole planning and response process. So these three are serious concerns for many of us, and we worry that this is the direction in which some of this is headed. That is, the projects and the ambitions and the aspirations of this project may result, in fact we are already seeing it happen. One of the ways in which we are seeing it happen very starkly is when we talk about exclusion. It's not just about people getting excluded, but it's even when it reaches starvation, deaths, and it becomes clear that, you know, people are dying because they're not able to use their UID number, or they're not able to link it, or their biometrics don't work, they're not able to enroll. If it is any of these and you say that there are deaths, increasingly we are beginning to hear from various people who support the project that, you know, it, after all, people die anyway. People were dying even before. So the idea that a new project is only killing as many people as an earlier, you know, as it was before this, is a chilling thing to hear from anybody. And so these are the kind of contexts that we are seeing. So the first part of it, where it was digitization, there was very little resistance to it actually. The only time I think there was some anxiety was when, which came from the railway unions, when computerization was introduced into you know, into the ticketing process. But when digitization started of all the records that the government holds, there was very little resistance, and nobody saw any reason to resist it. After that, you find that it moves very quickly into the ID system, and in the, so it's, there is a kind of progression that we are seeing. We feel it's important to acknowledge the progression, because we need to see if in our understanding there are maybe other routes to this progression, and also to see where it could lead, because we have to learn how to think about this into the future. We can't be looking back the whole time. We look back so that we are able to look at the future. So the next major step that we see, of course, the next major step really was e-governance. The idea that everything should be done through e-governance. And there is a book called The Silent State, which gives us a, you know, in just a paragraph, it tells us how after the dot-com bust, the European Union decided that, you know, the technology companies were having a low run, and the and therefore the European Union was saying that we are going to you know, let's help the technology companies, because otherwise they will sink and they will be able to help us. So it's a quid pro quo between the two, and on its own it's not a problem that a government is going to help companies that are sinking if it's possible that those companies will be able to produce something that is useful to administration, to people. But you see the closeness between, closeness of aspirations between a government and the and business interest emerging during that time. And then you find that there is this whole idea of biometric IDs that comes in. It's not only in the developing world that they thought of this. In the UK, for instance, we know that there was a project that they started, but very quickly they realized that these were projects, this kind of project would result in serious civil liberties violations for people. Their concern was not about exclusion of people. They were more concerned that it would be a civil liberty violation. And also questions of cost, questions of, you know, how good such data would be and what implications it would have for people. So this, and there was a whole ID project that the LSE took up, which helped in systematically identifying what all the issues were in this. And ultimately, it resulted in their scrapping the project in 2010. The US also thought about it, because after 9/11, you find that the UN, the United Nations, also starts getting into this panic mode, where they feel that they have to do things in terms of terror. So 9/11 becomes like a point after which the UN too becomes a panic-stricken reactor, in a sense. So they have these, you know, they bring in these things like money laundering, how monies will move. So it's all about terror funding. And we find that what the rules that were made for terror funding, saying that you can only move money across in a certain way, you can't give money to people, it has to be through banks. These were then converted in India, for instance, into both, it had to do with, you know, what the UN was saying, but it was also used to say it's for money laundering, and then imposing conditions on everybody. But initially, it's important that in India, we said that when it is no frills accounts and it's poor people, they don't need to go through this whole KYC, you know, rigmarole. Because it's small amounts of money and you want people to be able to access the system, this could prevent them from accessing the system. You find when the UID system comes in, they say, no, 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 now we are not going to do no frills accounts without any KYC. Now the KYC, when there can be a KYC, you bring the KYC, which is the UID. So the linking up of the bank account and of the UID number begins to happen with that. So even if it is not necessary for the banking system, because the poor in any case are only going to access and keep small amounts with them and small transactions, it became important for the UID to have it because they needed to link these up. We see that emerging. And we find that the next, in the next step, they start talking about the ID system, and it becomes a biometric ID system in India too. So in the US, when they did it, on the UN for a moment, they have started talking about an ID system, national ID systems. And there is a funny kind of conflation that's happened. You see, one of the human rights that we have is a right to identity. But that has now been reduced to being reflected in an identity system. And at best, to having an ID card. So, this idea of identity has got so distorted. And then you look at who are the people who are funding this whole exercise. And I know that one is the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. The other is OMIDIAR, and the third is the Australian government. So, it will also be interesting to see what the interest of each of these agencies is, because there must be some reason why they think this is worth putting all their money on, right? Now, in the ID systems have, the biometric ID system comes in at a time when, and this I think we need to do some self-reflection on this and how we do. How we speak about, how we publicly debate our own concerns, at least in part, and this is a, you know, I'm mooting this, that at least in part it was possible for such systems to come in because of the way corruption became the most important violation of human rights in this country for a long time. I don't think there's any denying that corruption is a problem in this country. So no one. And the RTI movement was a very important movement where the idea was that we'll make the state answerable to a people. But it seems to me, and this is just the way I'm thinking about it, that the idea of transparency and accountability did not get sufficiently developed even by us. So transparency started taking a life of its own and accountability a life of its own. And therefore, everyone and everything being transparent seemed to have become a normal way of thinking about it. So long as the state was not telling us that I am going to make you transparent, till then I don't think we realized what the implications of this kind of unbridled transparency was. And we find that when this project started, and it's an important fact that persons from within the RTI movement also had a problem with the kind of transparency that this project was bringing to us. We also see that this is, you know, the corruption debate has so overtaken many other things that there are many other things that have lost public space. Even the right to food has had to be, you know, become subservient in a sense. We are talking about the NREGA now and we are always talking about an ID project that goes with it. So, everything has become subservient to this idea of being able to identify yourself to the state. And that's a very significant shift that's happened. And I don't think as the people who worked in many of these issues, we've learn to re-articulate what our concerns are. We've learned to articulate our concerns about the project, but we've not, I don't think we've yet acquired the language in which to re-articulate how we envision this problem of corruption and why this is not an answer but a problem of its own. So in finding the ID system, we also know that in India we had we've had cases. I'm sorry, I just missed the US again. So in the US, the Bush administration thought of bringing in the real ID. They had a real ID project. They even had a real ID act. But they did not really go ahead with it because that as a biometric system, when they did their study, their National Academy found that, their National Institute of Standards and Technology found that biometrics are not entirely reliable. And in the report that they produced in 2010, you find that they say that, you know, fingerprints, iris, all these things are okay, but they are not going to be across populations and across time, they are not going to be very helpful. So, they were actually talking about looking at brain waves and all that. So, and you have Elon Musk recently talking about how the neural system is going to get linked up with the computer. Earlier, at least, this used to be talked about in a way where they said that, you know, persons with disability will be able to use it. And therefore, they'll be able to communicate without having, you know, like a facility for persons with disability. We find that very quickly it just transfers itself to whole populations who might find themselves being, I mean, depending upon the viability of this and how much they are able to try, for it to get become a proliferated technology. And in these years, the other interesting part of this is that the idea of DNA as an identifier, not only in criminal situations but generally as an identifier, and the various kinds of things that can be done through DNA and the, you know, that is being talked about, we see that has also grown around the world. So, we find, for instance, that on DNA, they are talking about in medicine, in health, for instance, in health systems, they would talk earlier about treatment, When you get ill, you get treated. Then it went to preventive. So the idea that, you know, if you have clean water, that kind of preventive. But then preventive became vaccines, and there are, you know, there are debates and the problem with debates around vaccines. Now they are talking about predictive medicine. And the idea about predictive medicine is that we don't even let a person fall ill. We'll be able to, you know, identify and catch it much before. So for instance, they will, you know, we just as a joke, we often say that now when two people want to get married, they won't go to an astrologer to see their horoscope, but they'll get their DNA tested. Because that will say, you know, whether what will happen for a few generations, and that's fine. We are finding that this idea of DNA as something that could be used for predictive medicine also means, carries with it the danger that already in many countries, and India is a classic example, where health budgets are so low, 50% of that will end up going to, and that's what they'd asked for actually in the 11th plan, one of those study documents in one of the recent, maybe it was the 10th, whatever, the lead up to the plan document, it asked for 50% to be used for predictive medicine. So you have DNA everywhere, and you'll be able to see whether, you know, I'll get breast cancer or not, or whether it should be removed well in advance. And then if you have a propensity for diabetes, then there will be some things that will be done in advance. And there are two people who, one sociologist and a scientist who, you know, geneticist, the Roses, Stephen Rose and Hilary Rose, who in one of their interviews, they've written a very interesting book, and in one of the interviews around that, when they were saying, talking about genetics and how it will be used for predictive medicine and where you need to locate the gene, and they said, you know, people are looking for the gene that produces obesity in America. Actually, it's in McDonald's. If you're looking somewhere else, you're not going to get it. So, but this idea that everything can be tutored to fit various purposes, this is also part of our climate today. So when we are thinking about these technologies and the way these technologies are emerging, we need to keep that too in mind. So in the ID system, when we brought it in India, we know that at least three companies have been involved in it at different stages. The first was TCS in 1999-2000, when they were asked after the Kargil war to explain what could be done, what would be the cost, what would be the, you know, dynamics of doing an ID project. They did it for the government and for the Home Ministry, and they also did it for the state of Gujarat. And we have the state of Gujarat report, and it's actually quite fascinating, because at the time, for the first time, they introduced biometrics as a part of this ID system. And they also introduced the idea that this will be used not only for public services, but for private and commercial transactions. So different entities should be able to use it. Now, if there is a resource, it will be used. So the question is whether a person's ID can be treated as such a resource. And that has become an administrative and a system related question, and not a political question at all. And that's been one of our problems, because we need to understand what it means as political beings to have our IDs structured in this kind of way. Then we had in the Wipro, Wipro coming in, and they did their task in 2006. And that actually forms the basis of the ID project that ultimately emerged. And then we have Mr. Nilakani coming in. So that wasn't a company, but he has since set in place many systems and gone back to Infosys, and therefore there is some kind of connectedness that we cannot but see. Now, in this is the this is where the ID systems are going. The ID system did not stop with the ID at all. Like I said, first of all, the ID could not stand on its own. And therefore, they needed the Trinity, the Jam Trinity, and the Jam Trinity can only operate together, which means that if you don't have a mobile phone or you don't have a bank account, it's a problem, because you have to be able, and they're looking at, you know, various factors of authentication. One of the early NIUs which was set up was the National Payments Corporation of India, and Mr. Nilakani and his people were also part of that, you know, where they were advisors to the National Payments Corporation of India to see how they could integrate the UID into the NPCI system. So these are all connected projects, and they are not single standalone projects and startups of various kinds. So we need to understand what these connectivities mean. The other part of this, the next part that we see is that in this connectedness, we also have multiple databases as having been created. Now, in these databases, so you find that every place where it is possible to locate the ID, you have notifications or instructions or threats saying that you must put your ID inside these systems. And what does it's an indication for us about people are not just asking us to do it because they are bored. There's a logic to why they are asking us to do it and why there is a compulsion in the way in which they are asking us to do it. So there is, that compulsion takes me to the next thing, that just 1 minute. Come in, come in. No, no, you can't come. You have to come in. I know sleeping through it. This is not a kacheri. For a kacheri, we'll say that if you sleep, if you put a cat to sleep in a kacheri, you're doing a decent job. But not if you talk. It's a lullaby here.
Sorry for disturbing your.
Actually, we accept all apologies. Even when they are not made, you didn't need to make them. If they do, I'll accept it. So the next thing that we therefore need to, you know, need to apply our minds to is why this number in every database? And there are some answers that are emerging in this context. We also need to see at this point that there are multiple ways in which this project is being worked out, because the project now is not just the ID project. The project starts with digitization, it goes on to creating an ID system, it goes on after that to putting it in multiple databases, and this project is enforced through state coercion. So there's a very interesting relationship that we see therefore between the state and various possibilities of use of this kind of these kind of systems. And those among the many uses, one of the really important ones is the way in which the private sector is getting involved in this. So we throw it back a little bit, we go to the 2011 TAGAP report, we see that the way in which this is being talked about is to say that government can't handle data, give it to private companies. We find GSTN is a private company. So today we find that the income tax department says that you all put your UID number and give it to us. GSTN has UID number everywhere, and now we are going to share our data with the GSTN. So a government department will now share the data with a private company. How do they allow themselves to do this, and where do they get that power from? So the question that has been asked kind of in different places, but it's asked rhetorically and not seriously enough, is whose data is? And the answers have come in various forms, and I think we need to discuss a little bit about what we want the answer to be, what it is for each of us. So there are some American senator, for instance, who says that, you know, Google and Amazon and all these people, they have so much of our data and they are monetizing that data. So we should pass a law which will make them pay each person, whatever, maybe $25, $50. They say, why should they make all that money? Let them pay to all the hundreds, you know, billions of users that they have. And they should be made to pay. But what that does, and the, you know, people who are contesting that idea are saying that what that does is to say that it is all right to treat that data as property which can be transacted on. And ultimately each individual may get a, you know, a little bit of. Of one's personal information is not, cannot be converted into property. It is a person's right. Identity, in fact, is being sold, which the UN should never be agreeing to. Identity is being sold when you say that you can take my data over and do what you want. So that is it's a debate that we are not having, which we desperately need to have. We also know that private companies came into it at different points. We've seen it in 2011 was the SAGAP report. In 2012, there was a policy document that was put out on data sharing, which is put out by the government, and the government says that, you know, different departments have various kinds of information. each of those departments owns that it is their property. Now they have by a policy document actually taken over property rights in all our data, and that's, I mean, I'm a lawyer and I can't see how that can ever be sustained. In fact, a policy is a non-justiciable document, it's not a law, and you can't just by a statement of the executive say that I'm converting your life into my right. It's not even possible. But it has been done and we have not recognized it, and therefore our responses have not just not been strong, they just haven't existed. So we need to learn to recognize some of these, and we'll have to figure out what we want to do with each of this. In the midst of all of this, we find that there is a resurgence of talk about AI, artificial intelligence. And artificial intelligence is actually something that everybody knows something about and nobody knows much about. So, but the interesting thing that people like, you know, some of us oldies here find is that when we were young, they were talking artificial intelligence. Robots were the big thing, and that, you know, Isaac Asimov and iRobo were the greatest bits of literature that we had read, and continues to be the best bit of literature I have read in science fiction. And so we find that this idea that intelligence from various places can be taken and converted into something else, which can then supposedly service humanity, so long as there are certain basic rules that are built into that intelligence, is the way in which this was projected for years. But why is it that between the time I was a young person, I mean really young, to my being really old, there has been very little talk about AI, and there is a huge, you know, resurgence of talk about AI today. And we find that that perhaps happens. So one of the ways of thinking about this is that this is happening. We managed to find a way by which personal data can be harmed and made visible. It's possible now to gather all this data, because earlier till you didn't have any system by which they all our records were held in different silos. Most of them were held in any case in, you know, in registers. And I just got a government document 2 days ago, and I'd neatly written it out. In fact, you know, printed it out and given the address, and the address wrongly digitized. So now we have a system where the registration of your ID will not reflect you, but you have to adopt what the registration reflects, because it is not about you. We have another trinity that has emerged during this period, and that has to do with this financial revolution that they are looking to do through this fintech companies. And the three words in that are cashless, paperless, and presenceless. So it's become irrelevant now where you are, who you are, what you look like. It doesn't matter at all. What they need is that once it is cashless, we don't need to see you. It doesn't matter who you are. It doesn't matter what you need. It doesn't matter, nothing matters, because you're presenceless. How does this idea of presenceless become possible? It becomes possible because they put in place systems which don't require your presence. So you have e-sign, you have e-KYC, you have digi-lockers, you have consent architecture, none of which requires your presence. It only requires an indication that whatever that ID is that is being transacted on, that ID is reflected somewhere. It doesn't matter who you are. And why is this so important, and how is it linked up with something like artificial intelligence? Now, Mr. Nilakani gave us a hint of that when in one of the Economic Times interviews, he told us that this is about trickle-up. Trickle-up is where all of us, many of us may not have anything to give to the market, but all of us have something that can become the economy. So all, which is data, personal data, all this data has to trickle up, and then it will be converted into the economy. You find that in the Shri Krishna Committee report, not the bill, but the report, start with saying that, I mean, very early in the report, they say that, you see, by the time the Shri Krishna Committee report, if you remember, was constituted, because the Attorney General had gone to court and said that there's no right to privacy. And the court was hearing the case on privacy. When the court was hearing the case, the court was seemed to be inclined to say that privacy is a right of the people. that time you had the government go in and say, anyway, we are setting up a committee. You know, they are going to look at data protection, so you don't have to worry about it. So the court, instead of not giving a judgment, they gave a judgment, but they also said that the government has said that they are setting up this committee, so they will come up with data protection principles. So this came at a time when the government and industry and the UIDAI and people like Vidhi Legal Center were working very hard to say that people don't have a right to privacy. And when that got defeated in the court, the next step that they did therefore was in the Shri Krishna Committee report to introduce an idea where they said that, you know, actually you don't, you all have a right to privacy. Of course, they couldn't say after 9 judges had said we did, they can't say we don't have it. But they said, you all have a right to privacy, but this right to privacy, you know, why you have it? So that you can contribute to the common good. And this is part of contributing to the common good. And if you look at it, the whole thing is about how you're going to create an economy. The one way of reading this report, and it will be useful for us to see if there are other ways of reading this report, is to see this report as being a way, being a means through which personal data, this is not personal information. Now, when we say data, it sounds like something neutral. We now know that this is not neutral. It is about personal information. That personal information is going to transmit itself to various places, and they will then make business out of it, and that's how we are going to develop our economy. So it is no longer, just all this is to say that it is no longer about, you know, do we have an Aadhaar or not? Do I enroll, you know, and put it here or there or not? It is about a change in our status. It's about a change in our relationship to many things in the world around us. It is about a change in our relationship to who we are, how we get reflected, and how that gets used. So the debate is far vaster than merely saying, you know, should I enroll for a UID today or not? Should I put it in this? You put it in, you know, you enroll, there is one whole set of places it goes. So you get database already. And then there is, in the UID project, there is organic seeding and inorganic seeding. So you can either go and put your number in your bank account, or they can inorganic, I mean, without asking you, they can just put it into the account. They don't need you really for that. So you, in your passport, you may not, you know, you may say, I don't want to give the number, and it may be voluntary. But they can go ahead and put that number there anyway. There's nothing to stop it from happening. So we are now in a place where entering this system has no opt-out. And I'll just stop there for a minute to say that friends from Meghalaya who had gone to the court, who had filed petitions in the court, who had battled all of this, when they found that the Supreme Court judgment, the majority judgment, was saying that you can exit the system if you don't want to be in it, only people who are, because they made an exception in all of this, which we'll come back to in a bit, for the poor of this country. They said those who are not looking for any kind of benefits or welfare from the state, the rest of you, if you want, you can exit the system. So a number of them sent letters to the UIDAI saying, we want to get out of the system. Two days ago, I got a mail from them saying that they have received the letters that they sent. They had spent 22 rupees per letter, and a large number of them had sent it out. It all come back to them unopened. So there is a way in which we need to understand what this means. See, it's too easy to think of everyone as bad people and good people. It's, the world doesn't work like that. But there are, we do need to understand what these ambitions are and why these are happening. So now the technology world. Now, we know all the debates that are going on around H-1B visas and whether spouses can work or not. Some of the Indian Express once reported that techies, you know, who are in the US, they've been saying at that time, about a year or two ago, that they would help Trump in building the wall, that they would contribute to the building of the wall, so long as they get their H-1B visas cleared. So there are, you know, various ways in which this kind of engagement has been happening within the tech world. But outside of this relationship between the tech world and the world outside tech has only been through our occasional straggler friends who've been kind enough to explain some of these terms which we don't understand at all and understand these technologies, which at least understand the meaning of what these technologies are. Now, in artificial intelligence, the one thing that it needs is data. As much as it can get, you know, when we say there's an overload of data, it will become a problem. For AI, they don't mind. They just give us anything, we'll keep crunching it, which is also why biases enter it, because it depends on what kind of data gets in, it depends on how the data gets reflected, it depends on how it gets collected in the first place, who has what prejudice even in the collection of it, who has what prejudice in seeing how to read that data. So there are a whole, let's put prejudice aside and say just judgment on what, you know, how they view all of this. So when you look at all of this, you find that the reason AI seems to have come back now is because today you have digitization, you have an ID that will go across various databases, you have multiple databases that have this ID. Every transaction is now requiring. It's not just that you're going to be authenticating yourself or verifying yourself in a system, but you're going, every transaction that you do will be visible for various people to pick up and to use. And that's a lot of information that they have, and it's going to be across time and across population. So it's a lot of data that AI now has. And so you find, for instance, that the GSTN, whose job, you know, the purpose of setting up the GSTN was that you have a goods and services tax system around the country, and you need a, you know, you need a back office for this. You need a technology back office so that it can deal with all of this.
Now, it
is a private company. We are asking it now, but you know, okay, so let me just give you a brief on the GSTN. 2011, you have the tag up report. One of the main things there is the GSTN. And when they are talking about the GSTN, in one paragraph, they talk about how the data that comes in can very often be garbage in. So, how do you change that? Because not the system will clean itself. Because if it doesn't work for you,
it's your responsibility.
There should be a way in which you will suffer. So if my biometrics do not work, then I am going to suffer for it, and I will go back 10 times to try and re-enroll because I can't collect my rations unless my biometrics work. Right? And if I don't, see, if my biometrics don't work, then the only way I can re-enroll is if I have a mobile phone. Because how are they going to authenticate this, how are they going to verify this right person who's coming to re-enroll? I can then go as you and say, oh, my biometrics is not working. Now put my fingerprints on that, right? So they need, for re-enrollment, they need you to have a mobile phone because they'll send an OTP on it, and you have to give that. So that has to be registered with the UIDAI. And so you find that, you know, this is the system that they follow. Now in GSTN, in 2011, after the report came in and garbage in, garbage out, and self-cleaning and all these suggestions were made, and they talked in that report, they said that this would be, you know, all this data would be given to a private company set up for that purpose, where government can have between 26% and 49%. The majority shareholding will be with a private company. Now, GSTN itself is a company that was constituted by HDFC, HDFC Bank, ICICI, NSDL, and LIC Housing.
It's a basic state function as tax collection. How can that be outsourced?
Thank you. So that is the question that we need. It's not just outsourced.
Well, yeah, I mean privatized.
It's much worse because the data today doesn't even pass through government. 2 to 5 billion vouchers, by Mr. Nilekani is saying, goes directly to this company, which then analyzes the data and gives, you know, so it conducts the task. The other thing also to remember is there's a lot, because these are a few technology companies that are getting involved in all of this, and there's a lot of conflict of interest in this. So, for instance, Mr. Nilekani becomes part of, you know, he becomes the chairperson of UIDAI, then after that he, you know, he writes this tag up committee report, then GSTN gets set up. So in 2011, so it gets set up. Then the first big, you know, among the big contracts given is to Infosys. Then because of circumstances in Infosys, Mr. Nilekani goes back to Infosys at the same time the GSTN, you know, work is being done by them. There's a lot of conflict of interest, which, you know, in the US they are still concerning themselves with antitrust and monopoly regime, which is what all these companies are bringing in, because they just gobble up all the smaller companies so that nobody else can come in anywhere. But in India, it is a little different in the way in which it works, where we are seeing a different kind of relationship between the state and these companies. And the business interest is sitting they're doing government work with them and sharing that information. So as people, we need to be able to understand what all this means, and you know, we have to, there's a lot of deciphering for us to do, because it's only when we decipher all of this we'll even know how to engage with the state, you know, on any of this. And it is important to do some crystal ball gazing, because, and what does it mean? It means that some of the haze has to shift. Without that you can't do it. 2012, Pranab Mukherjee, who was then the finance minister, announces in the budget that GSTN will be an NIU, National Information Utility, which is what the tag up report calls these private companies. 2013, long before the GST amendment has come, long before they set up that system, the company is already registered with the registrar of companies. So when they, when it, and then you find that when they start in 2016, when they begin, the GSTN is already in place and the data goes directly to them, and then the contracts are given to certain technology companies. Now you find after that, I think last year 2018, the GSTN said that they would be using the data that they have to start working out a credit giving system. So what is it? Now you're creating a fintech business where you say, I can see all the people who are on this, you know, I can see granular, you can see it, you can also see it in, you know, and create algorithms out of it. So they were going to create, you know, they've been creating algorithms which will help them see who they can give, who needs loans, in what season do they need loans, what kind of money is it that they will need, and then we will offer them money at that time using the consent architecture. So it's basically you reveal yourself to this private company, and the private company then decides what is the least, you know, risk, I mean, what's the most risk-free way in which they can give you loan, and then that is passed off. So it's quite interesting, because when the Supreme Court case was on, there were five business entities which appeared in the Supreme Court saying in January 2018, where they came and said that, listen, please don't change anything in this project because our business will go fat if you do this. One of them was the Digital Lenders Association. So for them, digital footprints is very important. But for the GSTN, it's a huge advantage, because everybody's, you know, everybody who's doing any business of any kind, every consultant, if you notice, everybody is put on that database along with a UID number and a GSTN number and a telephone number and a bank number. Anything more? So basically, and then they will decide who they are going to give credit to. That was interesting, because the government, there were reports that the government had stepped in and said that now we are going to make GSTN into a 100% government company. Because all this was being, after demonetization, it was important to reach the small person, and this seemed to be now a very good way, which, you know, the government hadn't thought of before, but a private company was going to do. I have no idea what happened after that, but the next report was that, you know, after saying it across 2 months, then they said, then it died down, and it continues to remain, it continues as a private company. And so this ability to be able to see, to know, to decide what to do with people, and to have a, you know, you've seen these all these crime files and all, no, you'll find that there'll be a window kind of thing where you can only look in, but the person inside can't see you. It's a little bit like that. So now you know who you are. But apart from that, so this is the kind of thing that we need to be able to understand. I just want to give one illustration at this point on what has, how this thing is. See, we know the fintech story somewhat, but we don't, we know very little about the health story. So when the UID project was started, we find that one of the early documents, along with NREGA, UID and NREGA, UID and PDS, they also had UID and public health. It's a 1.5-page, you know, skimpy document which really doesn't say very much, except that it says that health would be a killer application on which they could, I'm sorry, but it's not my language, it's there in the document, that it will be a killer application which will help them garner a lot of information. So the whole thing was about which are the applications which will help us get all the enrollments and which will keep us in, help us in updating that information regularly, because that information shouldn't become, it shouldn't become so backdated that it has no validity at all. So regularly, it's not enough to enroll. You have to keep using it so that you keep updating that information. if you've changed your residence, if you've, you know, if you change your name, if you've changed your status, if your biometrics have changed, all that has to be constantly updated within the system. So one of the things that interested us was why the UIDAI kept saying that we don't have any information with us. We have only bare minimal information. We don't keep anything else. And it's not untrue. The UIDAI does not itself collect all the health data and collect all this other, you know, PDS data and keep it with itself. What it does is to act as a bridge between all of them. In addition, the authentication log tells them where all you have your various kinds of activities, which gives them a profile of who you are. If you never go to a PDS shop, then you're one kind of person. If you go to a PDS shop, you're one kind of person. If you get job in NREGA, you're one kind of person. If you're in the EPFO, you're one kind of person. If you're getting social security pension, you're so it gives various ways. So now for AI, applying AI to this will make it possible to categorize these populations in various kinds of ways and figure out what kind of businesses can be done with this. Now the Sri Krishna Committee report does one more thing which may be for us, which is the discussion that they had on innovation. Now if you read the white paper which before the final report, you'll find that in that white paper they say that there are two models that we could follow. The first model that we can follow is the American model, and the second model is the EU model. American model is the laissez-faire model, where companies do what they will because companies are free to do whatever they want. It's the libertarian model. The model is the rights model, where they say that you have to respect the rights of people in any kind of technology applications that you have. And what was being advocated here was the American model, saying that, listen, we also need to have all these big companies. So you find that one of the ways through which they want to, you know, want Indian companies to flourish is by doing data localization. When you do data localization, just doing data localization produces its own business. You find Adani is going to have a huge plan. They're going to be one of those who are holding data. Now, when you data localization, it's not as if each person will be holding it in their servers. It will be all, you know, an aggregation. And Adani is looking to do it. There are many others who are looking, you know, this is big business and you're going to be holding all this data. What are you going to do? Data localization is something that is pushed in the Sri Krishna Committee report. It's the interest of the local businesses. It is good, like Mr. Mukesh Ambani was when he spoke about this, where he said that data of Indians, why is it sitting in America and, you know, wherever else? It shouldn't be outside the country. It should be here because it should then be with Indians, at least with Indian companies. So these are stated things. So we just, you know, many of these we really don't need to do any interpreting. They're telling us and we need to learn how to understand this and what we do with this kind of thing. Now for some of us this is very scary. Not only because our monies will go and our lives will go and our freedoms will go, but because we know that the poor in most countries are just being treated like they are a burden on the state. So for many companies, it's the libertarian view that is being propagated through this data localization and through this idea that you should not have any fetters in how companies function. Now that libertarian way of looking at this does not really any room for people who are not relevant to the market. We know now, after 20, 30 years, we know now that the market has failed. But we also know that the power of those who control the changes in systems will not allow this failure to be acknowledged for a very long time. They'll push it as far as they can. And in the meantime, what happens to them? And just yesterday, I was reading a review of a book about James Buchanan. And it's fascinating to see what those ideas were, and I think we also need to look at some of these other people who've been spinning off these theories, because those theories are now being used. Where, why, how is it that in a country like this we have such extremes of year? Have in 1 year 73% will produce being with 1% of the population. How does it even happen? And why is that seen as something that cannot be addressed? Why is, I mean, how, so this, these questions are not unimportant questions, and the answers lie in the places where we usually look. So we might learn to look other ways just to understand what these phenomena are. Now this, it's not only data localization that report talks about. If you read the draft of that, the Sri Krishna draft, and that's what's going to be picked up by the government, and you know, when they're looking to make a law, there are two, three things about it that are very interesting. You have to forgive my use of the word interesting.
Now we've understood it by now, what do you mean by interesting?
I'm not sure you understood it right. There are many other things you saw and got it wrong. Or didn't get. So, one of the things is the way in which they treat this idea of data collection. See, the thing is, when the AP Shah committee report worked, and just as a declaration, I was part of that committee. And I remember all the discussions we had on this idea of some of the nine principles that we put in place. One of those was on data. The idea of data transfer, you can't just transfer amongst yourselves, there has to be a whole consent, the consent of the person, you have to know, and there are certain ways in which you cannot transfer data. There is no point of transferring data. Now, all those rules are being broken down. So if you read the Sri Krishna committee report, there are all manner of loopholes in it to collect more information than you actually require. Now, where do we first see this? Openly. We see it when you look at the UIDAI's memoranda of understanding with various state governments and various entities. What do they tell them? They tell them, listen, we are getting into an MOU. You have to help us get you by giving back the number to you so you can link it up with whatever information you have. This is not an all, not an all. You also have additional data you want at that. So the poor are told, you go and enroll immediately, get yourself a number, put your number, otherwise you are not going to get your PDS subsidy. This is what they are told. So they have to go and do each of these things. They don't have a choice. And when they go and do this, they I'm going to skip a bit because I find I'm taking too much time on this. But it's basically to say that personal data, the idea of personal data and personal data collection becomes a part of what we were dealing with. So I'm going to stop there because I find I've got some three, four things and it's too much. I'll go on, I'll move on to the next thing of health. So we had UID and public health. Then after a few years, actually soon after the UID project started, you find that there is a committee that is set up which is going to look at how health records will be maintained. So initially it is health records in public hospitals, and they say this can be extended to private hospitals, extended to pharmacies, and it can be extended to anything within the health system. Now in this health records committee, you have TCS and you have FICCI. Now somebody was telling me about a meeting that happened in Chennai just a few days ago on the Smart Cities project. And he was telling me that I went for this meeting thinking that I would be hearing something, because if you look at the document is about how you'll have garbage disposal, how you'll do all kinds of things. And then, but when he went to the meeting, he says all he heard was data, 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 data. And he said, I couldn't see a single architect, town planner, nobody there. They were all people who were talking e-governance, and then they were saying, you know, people should be made to give data, but if they refuse, we should incentivize. And I'll send you the language. I mean, the language is just amazing. I'm not yet able to remember it because I just read it once when they sent it to me. But it's about this valuation and capitalization of that value, and it has nothing to do with a smart city except that the smart city's basic role is going to be generation of data. So one of the fascinating things that I find in this, and I think we could discuss it, it would be useful, is the extent, you know, if you look at PDS, for about 2, 3, 4 years, the whole focus in the PDS system was only in putting UID into it. And then they weeded out a large number of people. So if you look at Virginia Eubank's book, Automating Inequality, she actually demonstrates how something that is seen as a tool of inclusion is actually a tool of exclusion. And it is held, so if you don't conform, you are out. And your conforming very often is not in your control. So you are, you know, I can't make my biometrics work. You know, I can't not grow older. But that's my problem. That's not the problem of the system. That's what we are seeing. We are also seeing that the way these systems are structured, it excludes, it throws people off the system. So they'll say 11.5 lakh ration cards were cancelled because they did not link up with the UID. And then you say, who are these 11.5 lakhs? Have you gone and verified whether they exist or not? They say, no, it's their job to come and make sure that they are able to get onto the system. If you don't, you are one of three things. You are either a fake or a duplicate or a ghost. You can choose. I have chosen ghost. So, it, you know, we've reached that kind of point. And I think one of the interviews that we may want to see, because it tells us that there is a certain, that there are certain things that cannot be disturbed in this project. So there's a very interesting interview which Mr. Veer Sanghvi has with Mr. Nandanilekani. You can see it on YouTube. And Veer Sanghvi asks him three times at least during the interview, you know, if an 11-year-old has died because the system has not worked, doesn't it bother you? And I'll just request you to go back and see what his answers are. Because, you know, it's too easy to say these are bad people or good, you know, and these are evil people. It's just too easy. It's just that this system cannot operate with privacy. It cannot operate by making sure it doesn't exclude people. It cannot operate if it is with a feedback system. Till today, the only grievance redressal that you can have is, you know, is in a sense insulting us by asking us to call 1947. And leave a complaint. So I'm starving and dying here, and I ring up 1947. They say we'll deal with it. So there is no way you're going to get any kind of it. So it's plain that the system doesn't want to respond. I'll just, before I go on to the rest, the parts of hell, just to say this too, that the, just like data localization, the other part of what they deal with is the idea of innovation. And the idea is that innovation requires freedom. It can't be bound by rules. You can't tell an innovator that there is a constitution of India that guarantees fundamental rights to people. They're not innovators. Because if you're going to stifle innovation with fundamental rights, then that's really not going to work. So you need, you look at, I mean, because America left them free, you see the kind of things that they had. Now, nobody wants to talk Edward Snowden. Because America allowed them to do what they wanted, and because of the relationship between the state and America, and because in America, so people say, what about America? I say, please don't look to the US for human rights and fundamental rights. It's really not a good idea. And after Snowden, I don't know why we would even look at that. And it's fascinating the response that the Indian government of that day had to Snowden. They said, at least America is helping us deal with terror. And therefore, they have all our information and they can do what they will with it. So, it seems like from that response that we cannot expect the state to protect our interests in the context of sovereignty. Sovereignty of the nation. Sovereignty of the people is between us and the state. Sovereignty of the nation is vis-a-vis state. And it seems like we cannot depend on that. We also know that the you know, what we had happening in the Snowden thing also showed us that secret orders with a secret court, secret tribunal, secretly executed. All of these were the complicity, you saw the complicity of various companies in this. And there is a book that Glenn Greenwald wrote before Snowden happened about an earlier episode where the companies got caught out having breached the privacy rule, and then they got caught out. When they got caught out, they panicked because they were giving it to the NSA. There was no rule at that time saying that you know, if you give it to the NSA, you won't let your people know. In America, if they had gone to the court with it, then there would have been huge damages that the companies would have had to pay. So the Bush administration, he explains how the Bush administration then went and made a retrospective law saying that those companies did not have, you know, the breach notice would not apply to those companies. So there is a very, an enormous closeness that you find between these. But here when they say that innovation should not be stifled, they are saying that, like they did with UID, you do not want the law. You want the project to proceed. We'll see how much of it works. We'll see what kind of rules can fit the project and not the other way around. So this is something that we need to keep in mind too, because very often I get asked the question, now it looks like I have no choice but that I have to get onto this system. It's a question that I have to ask myself too, not only other people who are asking me. And then the answer to that is that actually you're not just getting onto a system. You're not getting onto an ID system and a registration there. You're getting onto a system which is taking you into many places which you don't even know what exists in those in those parts. Recently in Bulgaria, there was a data leak and data breach. They have no idea where the data has gone. They don't know who's going to be using it. They don't know when it will be used. And they don't know how to protect people whose identities have been stolen, which they say is something like 90% of the adult population. In the US, you had Equifax where the data got stolen and all the social security information got leaked, including biometrics. So when we are talking about this kind of, you know, why is it that when it's clear evidence, see, the evidence is not showing that these systems work. The evidence is showing that these systems are a problem parading in the name of a solution. And if these systems, if these failures can clearly be seen to exist, why is it that there is a push to carry on with this? Coming back to the health, just that we look at some of these documents, because we need to inform ourselves a little bit more before we are able to do some crystal ball gazing. So we need to look at some of these documents. Now, after that committee was set up, they brought out a report in 2013 on electronic health records. And then in 2016, that was updated, and you have electronic health records having come in. Economic health records tell us how every one of these, you know, every record, it has to be accessible across the country. Various people should be able to do it. The safety that they tell us is that only you and your biometric will be able to open. I mean, you will be able to open it. Only you can open it. But we know by now that biometrics are not being used anywhere except on the poor. Have you seen it being used anywhere else? Jio used it for a while. Have you seen it being used anywhere else? Is it not? When you put it in the banking system, it's not used. When you put it in the, and when they put it, and when they tried using it in the EPFO, they found that it was not working for most people. So we know that the failure rate of biometrics is extremely high, which means that it is the number and the uniqueness that number gives which is going to be used, and the connection that it has with the mobile phone number. So if you have a mobile number, I can find out what your UID number is. And if you have a UID number, I can find out what your bank account number is. So this kind of being able to open various databases with the multiple keys that are being created is something that we need to learn to get our head around. I don't think we've got our heads around it. The next document that came up was the National Health Stack. The National Health Stack is interesting because this is the first time there is an open admission. And it's not an admission because they don't see it as being wrong. So it's an open statement that India Stack and the National Health Stack are working together. So Niti Aayog has the India Stack people sitting inside there and telling them how they need to create a National Health Stack. In that National Health Stack document, they have the jam trinity. So, you know, it's like one project. Being able, the project therefore is to have all of us on databases, capable of being profiled, capable of being converted into data, capable of that data being capable of being converted into businesses. In 2013, there is a fireside chat. Please go and take a look at it if you've not seen it before. The fireside chat is between three people. That is Mr. Vinod Khosla, Mr. Srikant Nadamuni and Mr. Nandan Nilekani, and they are talking and they are addressing a team of techies and telling them, so how many more people have built up businesses which are based on the UID system? More and more people need to do this. So the idea that this data has been created for creating business is already, see, the what I will credit them with, those who have these ambitions with, is their openness. It's on YouTube, it's on the World Bank website, it's in documents, it's all openly said. So So these are not people who are doing things surreptitiously, and maybe I've got my understanding wrong, but there are, you know, for instance, on fintech, there were slippages that happened because demonetization got called at a certain time and not at another time. All these can be analyzed and we can try and understand what happened. So not all ambitions work, but many of these will work 40%, 50%, and that's enough for business. What it does to a people is a completely different story. And we may need to look at that and see what all this means. Then you have the National Health Stack. They say in that document that the data that you have, they say India will have the maximum amount because of the National Health Stack and how all medical data will be, health data will be collected. India will have the maximum amount of health data, and therefore, we in the global market, we are going to be, we're going to be very big because all this health data has been collected. So I just want to say one way we have come to think about this, which is, we call it the eminent domain principle. This is a country where for the longest time we've had, you know, from British times, with the Land Acquisition Act and before, Land Acquisition Act nearly formalized something that had existed before. And it has, there has been an expansion of the idea of the relationship between state and land. So earlier, while you used to say that there has to be a public purpose for which private land can be taken by the government on payment of compensation, now we have a slightly different version over the years that the government will say public purpose, it doesn't matter if that public purpose is not served, they can anyway take whatever land they want, and they can, you know, if it's right of way, they don't even have to pay, they don't have to go through a process, shrinking of procedure, all of that, is saying that basically all land in the territory of India belongs to the government. And therefore they are only taking back what is there. So that idea has kind of become part of how eminent domain has expanded. That has worked with water. You remember all the Coca-Cola wars that happened about who you're going to give off the river to, and you know, all kinds of minerals. And now we find that the human body and personal information are now being treated openly. This is not, I'm not just saying this. If you look at the Shri Krishna Committee report, you'll see that your data and my data are being talked about as national wealth. If you look at the budget, the economic survey this time, you'll find that our data is being talked about as a public good, which has to therefore be allowed to, you know, for the government to use and to monetize. If you look at what happens in Parliament, you'll find that you have a minister who goes to Parliament and says that we have monetized the vehicle registration data and the driving license data to the tune of some 65 crores and 35 crores. The government is treating our data and us as the property of the state. So the idea, you know, it's got inverted, where the state belonged to the people, now the people belong to the state. So how are we going to address this, and what do we understand by this? So some of the, and the two other things, so one is on AI. Therefore, AI has come back with a bang now because all this information exists. And when you look at all the information that is everywhere, which is identifiable information, granular, can also be made into, you know, made through algorithms to read and do multiple kinds of things to decide what kind of businesses can exist. And that all of our personal information has to serve the market, it has to serve GDP, it has to be a sign of growth. We are talking about something completely different. So the NITI Aayog also has a document on AI. They have a document on e-commerce, each of which, for instance, they are talking about India as being the marketplace for data. That will be, we'll be the data warehouse. So we are looking, and like Iceberg, which is, which is a very strong part of all of this, like Iceberg has told us, 1 billion of the world's population may be serviced by the Silicon Valley companies. 6 billion will be serviced by our companies here. So this idea that we need to colonize the rest of the world in terms of data is also one of the ambitions that exist. So we have to see what we think about this and whether it's okay or not, whether, as you know, whether our economy growing on the personal information of people in Kenya and in Tanzania and Gabon and wherever else, is it okay by us? And is that the kind of relationship that we seek with other countries? And is that the kind of power equation that we want? These are things that we have to, because we know that companies will have their ambitions. But when we speak to the state, we need first find avenues for speaking to the state. and then to be able to explain to them why we think this is not okay. That's part of the exercise that we may have to undertake. The kind of questions that we find that are coming up therefore are, some are immediate and some are a little not so immediate. So one question that has come up is, what do we do about income tax? That's a problem that many of us have had. Because the thing is, as a lawyer, I find it fascinating how we went through various stages. First saying it's voluntary, if you want, for your benefit, if you don't want, it's okay. And then saying that it's mandatory. Then when the court says it's not mandatory, because in court they said it's voluntary. And then the court said, okay, keep it voluntary. Then the UIDAI under Mr. Nilakani's chairpersonship actually goes back to court and says, allow us to make it mandatory because that's the only way this project can work. It's an official page document that they filed, an affidavit that they filed in the court. And then, no law, and then a law gets introduced because of pressure. And then when that law gets introduced and it's, the law is trashed by the parliamentary standing committee, you say, okay, you trashed it, then I'll go without a law. Then bringing in a law is a money bill. Then later, 2 years later, when the court gives a judgment saying private companies cannot use it, and this is the thing that we also need to think about. Private companies cannot use it was one part of the judgment. The other part of the judgment is actually far more disturbing, the way I see it. Because it's a kind of hit on constitutionalism. And somewhere that's the only protection we have between the state and us. And between even in relation to a court, that's the only protection we have, that we can go to court and say, this is unconstitutional. Now what the court has done is to say that, okay, the 9-judge bench has said that privacy is a fundamental right. They also said that you cannot waive anybody's fundamental right. Now this, you have a three judges, of these, you know, the three-judge majority judgment in the UID matter. They, 1 year later, they say that anyway, for the poor, privacy is not important. So we are going to waive the right for them. It's all right. And which is why, Colonel, when you say privacy is not important, they say in court, if you're going to use the court, you have to use all these methods because you speak to the court in a language they understand and which will increase the rights of people. But what did they do here? They turned around and said that the poor have only need for dignity and their dignity is linked up with having food. So if they are being given welfare services, then that is enough for them. I think we do need to apply our minds to this and try and understand why this is being done in the context of the poor. What is it that the court saw as being so important that they felt that the rights of the poor have to be whittled down so that this project can survive? What was it that made this happen? Because I think somewhere there is an abandonment of the poor that's happened in this whole thinking that we do. We think of mobile phone, we think of bank account, we think of IT, we're just not thinking of the poor. And the poor actually are dying every day. Our death may also come, but it may come, like Shakespeare said, when it will come. But here we are actually seeing it happen now. So why is it that, why is it that we are not getting agitated that this project is actually producing deaths and exclusions of various kinds? If a person with leprosy saying, I'm not able to enroll, it becomes a newspaper article. Then you have somebody from the UIDAI going and saying, no, to that home and saying, we'll help people enroll. Then you enroll. But every time for them to authenticate themselves and get it, they have to depend on somebody's goodness. It doesn't, because there's no system in place. So why is it that the most vulnerable in this country are getting abandoned by everybody? So this is not just happening with the state and companies. It's happening with everybody. The newspapers have at least begun to report when there is a death. If I tell you, and I don't know if you noticed this, the last death in Jharkhand actually ended in an exhumation. If a project is producing exhumation of a person, because the state said, oh, did he really die of starvation or did he not? I need to find that out before. So you exhume a body. Just think about what it means around us and why we are not shocked more than we are. This is one of the ways in which, it is important to question the project, question the government, question the state. But why is it that we don't even know the questions to ask of ourselves and of how we are responding to many of these? So the immediate question therefore is, what do we do about IT and actually, this is the land of Mahatma Gandhi, never mind who says what. And if there's one thing that is fascinating, everyone talks about that registration and caste system in South Africa, right? Mm-hmm. It's a fascinating story. Someday you must read it. There's a book called Man Before the Mahatma. And it's by a person called Charles DeSalvo. And he gives all the cases that Gandhiji dealt with when he was in South Africa. And he learned his politics and how to work his politics through, also through, you know, these cases that he did, test cases and whatnot. You find that when they went in for registration, they asked all the Asiatics to register and put their biometrics. And he objected. He said, nobody should do this. What kind of thing? You're treating us differently and you're coercing us to do this. And at that time, the understanding of what all this meant had not evolved very much. So they were basically saying, don't make this compulsory. You want us to enroll. Why are you treating us like this? So it was about the treatment that was meted out to the state, saying, I will compel you. You come, you stand in line, you put your thumbprint. He said, we are not going to do this. You treat us decently. Tell us, take away the coercion. We'll come and enroll ourselves. But I'm not going to tell you a whole story. But the fascinating thing in this was how a man who had gone there as a lawyer to some business houses is able we need to figure that out, to get 3,000 people in one South Africa to come to one meeting and say, no, we are not going to register because this is demeaning to us and we think this is wrong. When finally, and there is a whole string of stories before you come to the final part, where Gandhi had written a letter to the South African administration and then he got back. So there was some confusion about that. And because he felt he was a man of his word and he had said that I will voluntarily enroll if you take this, you know, coercion away, he went and he went to enroll. The people around him beat him up. He had, you know, he had bruises and maybe even broken bones. And they had to help him recover after that. So it was not a man who was some Mahatma who was being treated like he should just follow his word. When he did not stick to that word, they beat him up and he went to enroll. That's the time that it was. Why did he do it and how did it happen? What has happened to us that we think that we don't owe responsibility to ourselves? So what is this, you know, that sometimes you need to speak to the state by telling the state that they are wrong, by saying that this is not okay, therefore we are not going to be a part of this. You shouldn't be a part of this and you shouldn't be asking us to be a part of this. Second thing is that the income tax department today says that we are going to hand over all the data to GST. Shouldn't we at least be asking them if they intend to do this, because you can't have function creep like this. And if one person writes and two people write, then obviously they're not even going to listen. Why should they care? Now you find that if many people write, they send back unopened letters. That's our latest experience. So we have to find other ways of being heard if we care to be heard. Because there is, you know, there is a way in which we can allow these things to happen around us by not speaking. And it's important to speak to the state. I don't think cynicism has any role in this at all. We have to speak to the state and we have to speak in multitude and in multimedia. It can't be just through writing letters. It can't be just through going to a court. One of the things, this morning we were discussing this, the number of cases that are being filed, for instance, by one person who goes to the High Court and says, now, link the UID with voter ID with UID. Mm-hmm. What are the other things?
And property record.
Property record with the UID. And then the court issues notice on this. And who's on the other side? The state. And the state has all along been saying that we want to link it with everything. So who's going to speak up for us? So are we even watching this and what are we doing about it? Because it's all, you know, it can't become just a conversational exercise. It has to be more than that. Because without sounding, you know, without making too much of it, I think we are actually passing through dangerous times, because the people who understand what is happening and are doing this, which is basically persons in the world of technology, and not even the persons who work in technology, each of whom is given a separate task, but technology controllers, those who are controlling the whole idea and or say the poor of this country or the middle class, they care about the market, they care about their profit margin, and they care about what happens with them. Now, how do we teach them that we too exist and that you cannot have this manner of thing happen? So, are we going to speak to the income tax department and tell them that please give us a written assurance now and speak loudly in multiple places to say that you are not going to be, you know, the court may have said that you can use it for income tax purposes. But the court did not say you can do it without privacy protections. What are the privacy protections you are offering? If there is a breach tomorrow and this data gets out to somebody else, how will you let us know? Why are we not even asking them these questions? And if you intend function creep, where you are already proudly announcing that you are going to hand this data over to GSTN, we have not given the right over our data to you. We have only allowed you to use it so that you know we paid our taxes. And make them answer. See, this idea that we raise questions but we don't demand answers can't work. And you can't, I know, after that to tell the income tax department you should have answered us is feeble. So there are people, this you know, a state has to be responsive to a people and we have to teach them how they need to do it. But we need to learn first how we ask the question in ways. And that, you know, you can't keep waiting, they can't make a thesis out of this and spend 5 years understanding this. So we have to do it as soon as we can. The second thing is, I think we need really to immediately get clarity on this idea of data ownership, property, data as property and data as rights. In my mind at least, it's very clear that data is something so integral to oneself, and that's what the Supreme Court privacy judgment too would endorse. And that data is something that belongs in a way which it cannot become somebody else's. It's not even a kidney for me to donate. It can't get into this, you know, it's really not any of that. So how do we do this and how are we going to start addressing this data? This one other thing that we may want to debate is this thing of data protection. Because in data protection, they're telling us that we will keep the data and we'll keep it carefully. But you can't tell us we can't keep the data. And we are saying, no, it's not yours, you can't keep it. You use it for a particular purpose, get rid of it after that. It is not yours. So how then do we, because there are some youngsters who are looking at data protection as an answer to something. And they'll say, oh, there is not even data protection. Even if there was data protection, it would make no difference. So how are we going to address this? And we need to do these urgently. And what are we going to do about the expanding idea of biometrics, where now facial recognition has come in? In the meeting that we had in Tunis, we had the Microsoft person who said that we are doing facial recognition now and it's solving many of the heart-rending, you know, my heart is on my sleeve and it's bleeding kind of problem. So they said, you know, we've identified children and they've been restored to their parents. So he said, really, I mean, what is this age of children? Because actually very young children and very old people. So he said, and you know, persons with dementia, who just wander off, old people. Then he said, really, are you able to do this? And he had to admit later that very young children and very old people, facial recognition doesn't work because many of the things that identify, you know, that are the identifiers in a face, they fade out and they've not yet come. Little children, they fade out. Then we said, are you really telling us that 13, 14, 15 year olds who leave their house maybe because of abusive circumstances, you know, or maybe because of extreme poverty where you know, they can't even afford to be where they are, you're going to forcibly repatriate them into those homes? Is that what you're going to use this for? So there is no sociology, there is no anthropology, there is no politics, there is no law, nothing behind it. In India, Bangalore has this airport, two huge hoardings saying missing children have been found and taken back. If they've actually done it, they've broken the law. And whoever used the system for that has to be put behind bars. Because the act is very clear that you cannot use it for any of these purposes. Did they go to court? Did they get an order that they're going to use it? And who are these children and how did they find them? So this idea, and then less than 5, you're not allowed to use, you know, biometrics don't work. So what are they saying? What is it that they are saying they are using it for? It's an advertisement. You can say, and it is even possible that if they went into the system and used the system, maybe half a dozen children, they found their families with it. You go and try and enroll them and then you find that the biometric already exists. Then you check whether the same person is there or not, or whether they are, you know, whether it's a duplicate or if it is a new person who's wrongly been identified as the person. It's even possible you got up to half. So you're going to put everybody at peril because you're going to do this against the law. So these projects are never going to be bound by the law. And when you look, please read the documentation that's coming up now on how police are actually tracking this. There is a whole network that has to be put in place. It can't be done by these shortcut methods. So this kind of advertising. So one of the suggestions that came up yesterday in a Bombay meeting was to say, why is the advertising council doing nothing? Don't they owe a responsibility? Why do they have a regulatory authority if they are not going to work? No. So then we go to the bitter complaint. But when they see this kind of thing happening, actually there are many people who can complain even to within the council and take this up. These are not just saying your VIP box or your whatever, your attache case is of certain dimensions. This is about the liberty of people. And yet it is being done without any kind of authority of law. We need to worry about what all this. But we must remember that there is everywhere they are saying CCTV. Have we even investigated what this is? What does the CCTV do and what is it expected to do? You have facial recognition, now you have facial analysis. In the smart city, they are only talking about, you know, if you see some people who are loitering in an area, then they are suspicious characters and we have to go and check out who they are. Whoever is sitting behind the camera and looking at me is an extremely suspicious character. So, you know, there is that kind, how do we bring that answer to the pain and how do we reject certain technology? See, these are all technology, and remember this, that our responsibility doesn't stop with India. It goes to all, you know, after the Jamaican Supreme Court judgment, where the, you know, where the judge depended upon our minority judge, our dissenting judge, and said that he seems to have understood what the issues are, not the majority judge. And said, and what did the dissenting judge have? It had all the petitioners' problems which were reflected there. And they said, therefore, we cannot uphold the system. What we do here has implications, and we do it publicly. We are not doing it surreptitiously. So it has implications for other countries. And therefore, now our responsibility has grown not just to worry about ourselves. We have to worry about the poor who are getting excluded in various kinds of ways, and whose lives are going. See, one thing, for the longest time you keep saying science and technology. And in my mind, I think, and you know, even when you shorten it, you write S and T, as if it's just one thing. And then you realize it's not at all the same. Science requires evidence. Science requires testing. Science cannot, you know, without proof, you don't have science. Whereas technology, the way it is rolling out now, is about not knowing, but using whole populations as experimental. How are we going to respond to that? Some of these things, and one last thing of course is that we also need to think about things that don't seem immediately within our ken, but which is very much part of our thing. For instance, Mr. Indrakani had done a report on toll collection. And then he had, you know, there were various places where we saw, he had suggested that RFID should be put on every car. And then saying that it will make it easy for you to go across toll. And then In an article he wrote last year, he says, now we can have RFID readers at regular intervals, so you can manage urban traffic. And then you sell vehicle registration data, you sell driver licensing data. You think about what universe you're entering.
It's happening with Google already. Right.
Right.
Yeah.
So the question that we got asked, therefore, I didn't get a chance to answer it then, so I'll answer it now in IIT Bombay. That, you know, Google is doing it already, what's the big thing? And our thing was, the whole effort now, in the UK, in EU, the effort is to tone Google down and to find them every time they do something like this, and to make their profitability. In the US, there are whole presidential elections that are going to be fought on breaking these companies down. And we are using that as an example for why we allow our people to do this.
No, in the sense, like when you spoke about data being used for you know, managing urban environment, right? Like, I guess, like, such information, like, I mean, like, with proper regulation, proper regulatory channels, every, like, those bit of information can be of, like, good use for people, like, for common people. Like, for me, if I would know, depending on, like, when I see a satellite image of where I am, I would see where the traffic is dense and where the traffic isn't dense.
No,
so that could be through data aggregation itself.
So now what do you have? You have radio channels where they say wherever you are, just call in and tell us what the traffic is there. It doesn't track anybody. these are tracking devices. So every see, there is nothing that is totally useless. Even arsenic has its purposes, right? But we have to see how much of this is arsenic as poison and arsenic as resistance. And is this arsenic at all? The one danger that I found is that when we take a marketing statement, something to sell a product, for instance, I mean, I was just looking at the Smart Cities Project document, and the Smart Cities Project document is completely different. So in that also it will help you, you know, if I put RFID inside your dustbin, that it will help segregate garbage. Very good idea. What else is it tracking? And they, in the meeting that they have in closed doors, they are saying that use RFID so that we'll be able to track all of this. We'll have data on all manner of things, and that can then get, you know, become, because if you read, there's a book on RFID, which is in the next, I think it's called Spy Chips. Just take a look at the book, see what it says. Because, you know, in a marketplace, for instance, it's useful for them to know what are the things that you look at, how long you look at them, do you put it back, do you keep it in your bag. Everything is analyzed. So they know you better than you know yourself. If you're fine with that, that's okay. Just that you shouldn't ask it, everyone should be fine. So for people who voluntarily do it, I've had friends, for instance, who say, I've given my DNA because I want my ancestry to be. Okay, fine, you want to do it, you do it. At your own risk. Because you're not going to get anything. You'll get some report back, but it's going to be used in multiple ways. If it's okay with you, it's okay. Suppose the whole population's database